दिस लेक्चर वी विल स्टडी अबाउट द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड, अ पार्ट ऑफ द सेंट्रल नर्वस सिस्टम. नाउ एज वी वेरी वेल नो दैट द ब्रेन एंड द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड दे आर द टू पार्ट्स ऑफ द सेंट्रल नर्वस सिस्टम एंड आर द ओनली ऑर्गन्स इन द बॉडी विच आर इनक्लोज्ड इन बोन्स. दैट इज द ब्रेन इट इज इनक्लोज्ड इन द स्कल व्हाइल द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड इट इज इनक्लोज्ड इन द वर्टिब्रल कॉलम. Now, function of the spinal cord is that it acts as a sensory pathway. That means it will carry all the information from the various receptors and the organs towards the brain. And it will also act as a motor pathway. That means the information which is processed and integrated in the brain. And now all the message it reaches back to the effector organ through the spinal cord. So spinal cord, it will act as a channel to carry all the information to the brain, and also all the information will reach back from the brain to the spinal cord. And also spinal cord, it will act as a reflex center. That means these simple reflexes, they can be also performed by the spinal cord. Just for example, when we touch an hot object, we immediately move our hand. In these type of actions, there is no time for messages to reach up to the brain, and here the spinal cord performs simple reflexes and we are able to protect ourselves. So function of the spinal cord is that it will act as a sensory as well as motor pathway, and it will also act as a reflex center to perform the simple reflexes. Now clinically, the spinal cord, it can be involved in various traumas or injuries. Like in various accidents or traumas, the fractures of the vertebra can occur, and these fractures, they can also damage the spinal cord. And sign and symptoms in the patient will depend on the level at which spinal cord is injured. So higher the level of injury, the more will be the paralysis in the patient, as we see in this diagram. At the cervical level of injury, the patient can have paralysis of all the four limbs, while in lower levels of injury in lumbar region, there can be paralysis of only the lower limbs. So correct and adequate knowledge of anatomy and physiology of spinal cord is of prime importance, so that we can accurately localize and diagnose a disease or injury of the spinal cord. Moreover, the tracts of the spinal cord, they can be involved in various diseases like dietary deficiency of vitamin B12, or in infections like syphilis, or in degenerative diseases like syringomyelia. So in this lecture, we will study the basic structure of the spinal cord, and we will also know the position and functions of various ascending and descending tracts that are present in the spinal cord. And we will also try to know how spinal cord tracts, they can be involved in various diseases or injuries to the spinal cord. Now, first about the location and extent of the spinal cord. Spinal cord, it begins as a continuation of the medulla oblongata of the brain. So in this diagram, we can see the brain stem with midbrain, pons, and the medulla. Now, also we can see the first cervical vertebra with its posterior arch in this diagram. So at the upper border of the posterior arch of the first cervical or the atlas vertebra, now the medulla oblongata of the brain, it will continue into the spinal cord. So spinal cord, it will begin at the level of upper border of the first cervical or the atlas vertebra. From here, the spinal cord, it will continue in the vertebral column, and it will continue up to the level of the lower border of the first lumbar vertebra. So here we can see the lower border of first lumbar vertebra, and the spinal cord, it is continuing from the upper border of the posterior arch of atlas or first cervical to the lower border of the first lumbar vertebra. And this length of the spinal cord from the C1 to L1 vertebra, it is roughly about 45 centimeter in adult males and about 42 centimeter in females. And the weight of the spinal cord, it is roughly about 30 grams. Now, the lower end of the spinal cord, which we see at the level of first lumbar vertebra, it ends up in a conical elongated manner. And this lower end of the spinal cord, it is known as the conus medullaris. And beyond this level, now the spinal cord, it continues only as a thin filament of the biomatter that is known as the phylum terminale. And this phylum terminale of biomatter, it will continue up to the coccygeal vertebra. So extent of the spinal cord, it is from the first upper border of first cervical vertebra to the lower border of L1 vertebra or first lumbar vertebra. And the beyond the first lumbar vertebra, the spinal cord, it will continue as the thin filament of biomatter, that is the phylum terminale. Though the lower end of the spinal cord, it is lying at the level of L1 vertebra in adults, but in newborns, this lower end of the spinal cord, it is present at the level of the L3 or the third lumbar vertebra. The knowledge of this level of the spinal cord, it is of importance, especially when we are doing the procedures like lumbar puncture, where we must be very careful in newborns, where the spinal cord, it is lying at a lower level as compared to that in the adults. So this is about the extent and the location of the spinal cord. Now about the diameter of the spinal cord, if we look at the diameter of the spinal cord, it is not uniform in diameter throughout its length. At two places, that is in the cervical region, that is cervical enlargement of the spinal cord, and also in the lumbar region, which is known as lumbar enlargement of the spinal cord, the diameter of the spinal cord is more as compared to other places. At the cervical enlargement, the diameter of the spinal cord, it is about 38 millimeter, while in lumbar enlargement, the diameter is 35 millimeter. The minimum diameter of the spinal cord, it is seen in the thoracic region, where it is only 20 millimeter in diameter. So, and at these two places, cervical and the lumbar region, this enlargement is seen because more motor neurons, they are present in the spinal cord at these two places, and more motor neurons, they are for the innervation of the upper limbs at the cervical level and for innervation of the lower limbs at the lumbar level. So diameter of the spinal cord, it is not uniform throughout its length. At two places, cervical and the lumbar region, it shows the enlargement, the cervical and the lumbar enlargement, and diameter is more at these two places. Now we will study about the meningeal layers around the spinal cord. Just like the brain, the spinal cord is also enclosed in three layers of meninges. The outermost layer, it is the tough fibrous dura mater. The middle layer, it is thin and transparent arachnoid matter, while the innermost layer of meninges, it is a thin vascular layer of biomatter. First, we will study about the dura mater around the spinal cord. Though the dura mater of the spinal cord, it is also a tough fibrous layer just like the brain, but around the spinal cord, there is only a single layer of dura mater. So here we can see in this diagram, around the brain, there are the dura mater, it is double layered. There is an outer and osteal layer which is closely applied to the inner surface of the skull bone, and an inner meningeal layer. Now this an inner meningeal layer of dura mater from the brain, it continues around the spinal cord as the meningeal layer of dura mater around the spinal cord. So the dura mater of the spinal cord, it is single layer, and it is a continuation of the meningeal layer of dura mater from the brain. And this dura mater of the spinal cord, it will continue up to the second sacral vertebra. So here we can see that the although the spinal cord, it has ended up at the level of first lumbar vertebra, but this layer of dura mater, it is continuing up to the second sacral vertebra. Moreover, the dura mater of the spinal cord, it will not show any folds like that in the brain. So here in the second diagram, we can see that the meningeal layer of dura mater in the brain, it is thrown into various folds like fac cerebri or fac cerebelli. But around the spinal cord, there are no such folds. So the dura mater of the spinal cord, it differs from that of the brain in the sense that in the spinal cord, it is only single layered and only meningeal layer is present. But around the brain, there are double layer of the dura mater. And also the dura mater in the spinal cord, it does not show the folds which are present in the meningeal layer of the dura mater around the brain. And as the end osteal layer of dura mater, it is absent in the spinal cord. So a space is always present between the inner surface of the vertebral column and the dura mater. And this space is named as the epidural space. Such an epidural space will be absent in the brain where there is an end osteal layer closely applied to the inner surface of the skull bones. So an epidural space, it is present between the inner surface of the vertebral column and the dura mater of the spinal cord. This epidural space, it contains the loose areolar tissue, some fat, and also a venous plexus, that is internal vertebral venous plexus, is present in this epidural space. Now, advantage of this epidural space is that clinically this space can be utilized for injecting anesthetic or analgesic drugs. And this type of epidural analgesia, it is utilized for pain relief during the childbirth, that is in the painless labor or deliveries, or also it is used in the pain relief in cancer patients. While the epidural anesthesia, it can be used in various surgeries in gynae and obstetrics department. So the dura mater around the spinal cord, it is single layered without any folds, while in the brain it is double layered and with folds like Parc cerebral. And dura mater of the spinal cord, it will continue up to the second sacral vertebra, and an epidural space is present outer to the dura mater, which is used for analgesia and anesthesia. The next layer of meninges in the spinal cord, it is a thin transparent arachnoid matter. And there is a space between the dura and the arachnoid matter, which is the subdural space. This subdural space, it contains a thin amount of watery fluid, and this space allows the mobility of the dura over the arachnoid matter. The arachnoid matter, just like the dura matter, it will also continue up to the second sacral vertebra. So this is the middle layer of the meninges, arachnoid matter, continuing up to the second sacral vertebra. The next layer of meninges around the spinal cord, it is the pia mater. The pia mater, it is the innermost thin and vascular layer of meninges around the spinal cord. And this pia mater, it undergoes various modifications to keep the spinal cord in position during the movements of the vertebral column. The first modification of the pia mater, it is in the form of phylum terminale. So as we see in this diagram, the spinal cord, it ends up at the level of lower border of the first lumbar vertebra, but the pia mater, it continues beyond this level as a thin filament that is named as the phylum terminale. And this phylum terminale of the pia mater, it will continue up to the coccygeal vertebra. And a part of the phylum terminale, it is lying inside the dural sac, which is formed by the dura and the arachnoid matter. And this part of the phylum terminale, it is named as the phylum terminale internum. And length of this phylum terminale internum is roughly 15 centimeter. While the part of the phylum terminale outside this dural sac, it is named as the phylum terminale externum, and length of this part is about 5 centimeter. And this part of the phylum terminale outside the dural sac, it will be attached to the dorsal surface of the coccygeal vertebra. So this is the first modification of the pia mater in the form of phylum terminale, and total length of phylum terminale, it is about 20 centimeter with 15 centimeter lying inside the dural sac and 5 centimeter lying outer to the dural sac. The second modification of pia mater, it is in the form of ligamenta denticulata. Now, as the name is suggesting, denticulata means teeth-like. So, these are the projections from the pia mater, which are start extending from the lateral side of the pia mater. So, in this diagram, we can see these projections from the lateral side of the pia mater. These are the ligamenta denticulata, and these ligaments, they are present between the dorsal and the ventral nerve root of the spinal nerve. And if we look closely at these ligamenta denticulata, we can see that these tooth-like projections here in this diagram, we can see these projections. These projections, they will pierce the arachnoid matter and they will get attached to the outermost layer of meninges, that is the dura mater. So their attachment to the dura mater suggests that these are needed for the firm attachment of the spinal cord to the dura mater. And we can also see the relation of ligamentum denticulata to the dorsal and the ventral spinal nerve root, which are lying on either side of the ligamentum denticulata. There are total 21 pair of ligamenta denticulata, and first pair, it is lying at the level of foramen magnum, but the last pair of ligament, it is lying at the level of the first lumbar spinal nerve. And all the ligament, they are teeth-like in shape, but the last pair of ligamenta, it is fork-like. Here we can see in the second diagram, the last pair of the ligamenta denticulata. And this characteristic shape of the last pair of ligament, it is very useful during the surgeries on the spinal cord, where it helps to identify the first lumbar spinal nerve. So if we see a nerve in relation to this fork-like ligament, that is definitely the first lumbar spinal nerve, and we can now count the other spinal nerves in relation to this nerve. So this is the second modification of the pia mater in the form of teeth-like processes, ligamentum denticulatum, and these ligamentum denticulatum, they are attached to the dura mater. Total, there are 21 pair of ligament, and the last pair of ligament, it is fork shape, and it is very helpful during the spinal cord surgeries to identify the spinal nerves. The next modification of the pia mater is in the form of anteriorly as linea splendens and posteriorly as the subarachnoid septum. So the third modification of pia mater, it is seen anteriorly as a thickening in the anterior median fissure. So here we can see a linea splendens, which is a thickening of pia mater in the anterior median fissure. And also the posteriorly, the pia mater, it is thickened to form a subarachnoid septum. And this will attach the pia mater to the arachnoid mater in the posterior median sulcus. So these are the other two modifications of the pia mater in the form of linea splendens anteriorly and posteriorly as the subarachnoid septum. So the pia mater, it is the innermost layer of meninges, and it is modified to form phylum terminale, and it is also modified, as we see in the second diagram, ligamentum denticulata, linea splendens, and subarachnoid septum. And these modifications of the pia mater, they are needed to keep the spinal cord in position during various movements of the vertebral column. Now, a space also exists between the arachnoid mater and the pia mater. And this space is the subarachnoid space. This subarachnoid space, it contains the cerebrospinal fluid. Now, as the spinal cord, it ends up at the level of lower border of the first lumbar vertebra. And only the meninges of the spinal cord, they continue beyond this level. So the subarachnoid space beyond this level of L1 vertebra, it is quite wide, and a large amount of cerebrospinal fluid is present in the subarachnoid space beyond this level. So now here the Subarachnoid space can be utilized for collecting the cerebrospinal fluid for diagnostic purposes and also for injecting anesthetic drugs into this space during the spinal anesthesia. And this procedure of collection of CSF or injection of drugs, it is known as the lumbar puncture. And the lumbar puncture, it should always be done at the level between the third and the fourth lumbar vertebra. And reason for selection of this site is that as the spinal cord, it ends up at the level of first lumbar vertebra, so there will be now no chance of injury to the spinal cord if we select this site between the third and fourth lumbar vertebra. The second reason for selection of this site is that this position of third and fourth lumbar vertebra, it is easy to locate. As we see in the next second diagram, the highest point of iliac crest, it is lying at the level between the third and the fourth lumbar vertebra. So if we move our hand from the highest point of iliac crest towards the back, we will easily reach the site between the third and fourth lumbar vertebra. And third reason for selection of this site is that as the subarachnoid space is quite wide here, so large amount of cerebrospinal fluid is present in at this place. So lumbar puncture procedures, they are done to collect the cerebrospinal fluid for diagnostic purposes or for the spinal anesthesia. And site for preference for the lumbar puncture is always between the third and the fourth lumbar vertebra, and reason being the there is no chance of injury to the spinal cord, and this site is easy to locate as lying at the highest point of iliac crest. And these lumbar puncture procedures, they are either done in sitting position or in lying down position. With the back of the patient, it is flexed, so the interspinous space between the third and fourth lumbar vertebra, it opens up. And while doing these procedures, we pierce the supraspinous ligaments, interspinous ligaments, dura mater and arachnoid mater, and then we reach up to the subarachnoid space. And as the dura mater, it is a tough layer, so there is a resistance while we are puncturing this dura mater to enter into the subarachnoid space. So this is about the lumbar puncture procedure, and it should always be done in at the level between the third and the fourth lumbar vertebra. So this is about the three layer of meninges around the spinal cord, the outermost dura mater, the middle arachnoid mater, and the innermost layer, it is the pia mater. The dura mater around the spinal cord, it is single layered, and outer to the dura mater, a space is present, epidural space. And the pia mater of the spinal cord, it is also modified to keep the spinal cord in position during the movements of the vertebral column. Now we will study about the external features of the spinal cord. Now this diagram, it is showing the anterior and the posterior surface of the spinal cord. Along the anterior surface of the spinal cord, in the midline, a deep anterior median fissure is present. And this anterior median fissure is roughly about 3 millimeters in depth. In this cut section, we can see this anterior median fissure clearly, and along this fissure, the anterior spinal artery run over the spinal cord. Now, lateral to this anterior median fissure on either side, anterolateral sulcus, they are present. And at the anterolateral sulcus, the ventral nerve root, it leaves the spinal cord. So on the anterior surface of the spinal cord, an anterior median fissure and two anterolateral sulcus are present. Now on the posterior surface of the spinal cord, in the midline, a shallow posterior median sulcus is present. And on either side of this posterior median sulcus, two posterolateral sulcus are present. And along this posterolateral sulcus, the posterior nerve root or the dorsal nerve root of the spinal nerve, they leave the spinal cord. And along the posterior surface of the spinal cord, above the sixth thoracic vertebra, a posterior intermediate sulcus, which is a very faint sulcus, is present. And this posterior intermediate sulcus is present between the fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus, the two parts of the posterior column tracts. So on the posterior surface, a posterior median sulcus and two posterolateral sulcus are present. Now this anterior median fissure and the posterior median sulcus, they divide the spinal cord into an equal right and the left half. And each half of the spinal cord, it is further divided into an anterior, lateral and the posterior region. The anterior region of the spinal cord is between the anterior median fissure and the anterolateral sulcus, while posterior region is between the posterior median sulcus and the posterolateral sulcus. While the lateral region of the spinal cord, it will be between the two lateral sulcus, that is the anterolateral and the posterolateral sulcus. So these are the sulcus on the anterior and the posterior surface of the spinal cord. Now about the attachment of the spinal nerves to the spinal cord. There are total 31 pair of spinal nerves attached to the spinal cord. Out of these 31 pair, 8 pairs are of the cervical spinal nerves, 12 pairs are of the thoracic spinal nerves, and 5 pair of lumbar spinal and 5 pair of sacral spinal nerves, and the last pair, it is of the coccygeal nerves. And each spinal nerve, it is attached to the spinal cord by a ventral and a dorsal nerve root. The ventral nerve root of the spinal cord, it is motor in nature, while the dorsal nerve root, it is sensory in nature. And each root of the spinal cord, it is attached to the spinal cord by a number of rootlets. We can see in this diagram the fine rootlets of the ventral nerve root. Now, the dorsal root of the spinal nerve, it bears a dorsal root ganglion. And inside this ganglion, the pseudo-unipolar neurons, they are present, as we see in this second diagram. The pseudo-unipolar neurons, which are having a central process which pass towards the spinal cord and a peripheral process which passes towards the receptors. The two roots of the nerve, spinal nerve, the ventral and the dorsal nerve root, they join to form a spinal nerve, and this spinal nerve will now further divide to form a dorsal and a ventral ramus of the spinal nerve. So the spinal nerve, it is attached to the spinal cord by two nerve roots, a sensory nerve root, that is dorsal root, and a ventral root, that is motor in nature. Each spinal nerve will leave the spinal cord and it will pass along its corresponding vertebra. For example, if we say the fifth cervical spinal nerve, as we see in this diagram, this spinal nerve will pass along its corresponding fifth cervical vertebra. And similar is true for other spinal nerves. So for example, if we say second thoracic, this nerve, it is passing along its corresponding second thoracic vertebra. Now, each spinal nerve in the cervical region, we can see that the cervical spinal nerves, they are leaving along the upper border of their corresponding vertebra. So here it is the first cervical vertebra, and the first cervical spinal nerve, it is leaving along the upper border of first cervical vertebra. The second cervical spinal nerve, it is leaving along its upper border of second cervical vertebra. This will be true up to the seventh cervical nerve, which are leaving along the upper border of their corresponding vertebra. But there are total 8 pair of cervical spinal nerves and only 7 cervical vertebra. So now the 8th cervical nerve, it will leave along the upper border of the first thoracic vertebra. So now the first thoracic nerve, instead of leaving along the upper border of vertebra, it will leave the spinal cord and it will pass along the lower border of the first thoracic vertebra. So up to the 7 cervical spinal nerves, they are leaving along the upper border of their corresponding vertebra. But the 8th cervical spinal nerve, it will pass along the upper border of first thoracic vertebra. and the first thoracic spinal nerve will now pass along the lower border of the first thoracic vertebra. And now onward, all the spinal nerves, they will pass along their lower border of their corresponding vertebra. But since the spinal cord, it ends up at the level of the first lumbar vertebra, now the each spinal nerve in the lower lumbar, sacral and the coccygeal nerves, they have to take a very long and oblique course to pass along their corresponding vertebra. So as we can see in this diagram, the second lumbar nerve, it has to take this oblique course and then it passes along the lower border of its second lumbar vertebra. And same is the true for fifth lumbar, which is now taking a very oblique course and a long course to pass along its vertebra. And the sacral nerves, they will have to take a very, very long and oblique course to pass along their corresponding vertebra. And this long and oblique course of the lower lumbar, sacral and coccygeal nerves, it results in formation of a bunch of nerves in the lower part of the spinal cord. And this bunch of nerves, it gives a horse tail appearance known as the cauda equina of the spinal cord. And in this cauda equina, four pair of lumbar nerves, five pair of sacral nerves and one pair of coccygeal nerves, they are present. So the spinal nerves, they will always pass along their corresponding vertebra. And in upper cervical region, these cervical spinal nerves, they are passing along the upper border of their corresponding vertebra. But the eighth cervical spinal nerve, it will pass along the upper border of first thoracic. And from thoracic region onwards, all the spinal nerves, they will pass along their lower border of their corresponding vertebra. And the lower spinal nerves, which have to take a very long oblique course, they result in formation of cauda equina at the lower end of the spinal cord. This difference in the length of the spinal cord and that of the vertebral column is because the vertebral column, it is growing at a faster rate as compared to the spinal cord. So if we see in the first diagram, the spinal cord, it extends throughout the length of the vertebral column in third month of intrauterine life. But after this, the vertebral column, it starts growing at a faster rate. So in fifth month of intrauterine life, now the lower end of spinal cord, it comes to lie at the level of first sacral vertebra. But this vertebral column will keep on growing at a faster rate as compared to the spinal cord. So in newborns, the lower end of the spinal cord will now lie at the level of the third lumbar vertebra. And in adults, the lower end of the spinal cord, it is present at the level of the first lumbar vertebra. And the length of the spinal cord in the adults, it is about 45 centimeter, while the length of the vertebral column in adults, it is about 60 centimeter. And this difference in the length of vertebral column and that of the spinal cord is because the vertebral column, it is growing at a faster rate as compared to the spinal cord. Now we will study about the concept of spinal cord segment. Now, a spinal segment means the part of the spinal cord from which one pair of spinal nerve, it leaves the spinal cord. So in this diagram, we can see here the a pair of the spinal nerves. And this part of the spinal cord from which one pair of spinal nerve leaves the spinal cord, it will be named as the spinal segment. So in this way, there are total 31 pair of spinal nerves. So there will be total 31 spinal segments. There will be 8 cervical segments corresponding to the 8 cervical spinal nerves. And 12 thoracic segments corresponding to the 12 pair of the thoracic spinal nerves. And similarly, in the lumbar region, there will be 5 spinal segments. In sacral region, there will be again 5 spinal segments. While the coccygeal region, it is having only one pair of coccygeal nerves. So there will be only one coccygeal segment. So a spinal segment, it means the part of the spinal cord which give rise to a pair of the spinal nerves. Since there are total 31 pair of spinal nerves, so there will be total 31 spinal segments. Since the length of the spinal cord, it is just the 45 centimeter, while the length of vertebral column, it is roughly 60 centimeter. That means these spinal segments, they will not necessarily lie against their corresponding vertebra. So as we see in this diagram, the spinal cord, it is ending at the level of first lumbar vertebra, while the vertebral column, it is 60 centimeter in length. So the spinal segments, they will not lie against their corresponding vertebra. And the spinal segments, they will be lying at a higher level as compared to their vertebras. So if we see in an enlarged view, here we can see in the upper cervical region, the spinal segments, they are lying against their corresponding vertebra. But as we move down in the lower cervical region, this is the seventh cervical segment. It is now lying against the sixth cervical vertebra. So the spinal segments, they are lying at a higher level as compared to their numerically corresponding vertebra. And as we move down, we can also see that this fifth thoracic segment, it is lying against the third thoracic vertebra. So the thoracic segments, they are lying two level higher than their corresponding vertebra. And as we move down, we can see that the spinal segments, they are becoming more and more crowded. And at the level of the 10th thoracic vertebra, these are the lumbar segments of the spinal cord which are lying. And against the 12th thoracic vertebra, we can see here the sacral and the coccygeal segments. So that means the spinal segments of the spinal cord, they are not lying against their numerically corresponding vertebra. Spinal segments, they are lying at a higher level as compared to their vertebral level. And in the upper cervical region, the spinal segments, they will correspond to their vertebra. But in the lower cervical region, they are lying at a one level higher. And in thoracic region, the thoracic spinal segments, they are lying at a two level higher than their corresponding vertebra. And when the injury occurs to the various vertebra, now how can we know that which spinal segment has been injured? This can be done by this rough formula here. The upper cervical level, if there is an injury to the upper cervical vertebra, this will correspond to the spinal segment as we have seen in the previous diagram. But in the injury has occurred in the lower cervical vertebra, we have to add 1 to the number of vertebra, then we can get the spinal segment, as we know that the spinal segments, they are lying at a higher level as compared to the vertebra. In thoracic region, we have to add 2 to the number of vertebra to get the spinal segment, and in lower thoracic region, add 3 to the number of vertebra. And T10 vertebra, it is corresponding to the L1 and L2 segment of the spinal cord, while the 12th thoracic vertebra, it corresponds to the L5 to S1 segment of the spinal cord. So this is about the spinal segments which never correspond to their corresponding vertebral level, and the spinal segments, they are always lying at a higher level as compared to the vertebra. And this fact, it become important when the injuries occur to the various vertebra and we want to find out the level of the spinal cord which has been injured. So now this completes the external features of the spinal cord. Just a revision that spinal cord, it extends from the first cervical to the lower border of the first lumbar vertebra. Total length of the spinal cord, it is roughly about 45 centimeters. And lower end of the spinal cord, it is conical and elongated as conus medullaris. And beyond the conus medullaris, the spinal cord, it continues as the phylum terminale. एंड द स्पाइनल कॉर्ड इट इज सराउंडेड बाय द थ्री लेयर ऑफ मेनिंजेस. सो नाउ वी कैन चेक आवर नॉलेज बाय दिस असाइनमेंट. सो जस्ट पॉज दिस वीडियो फॉर 10 सेकेंड एंड यू कैन चेक योर नॉलेज हियर.